first stop on my geological tour is Cairo in Egypt. As holiday destinations go, it's hot, it's dusty, and it's pretty chaotic. Cairo certainly supplies an exhilarating feast for all the senses. As well as the giant medieval mosques, right at the heart of the city are the bustling bazaars.
That looks silly. Do it? Yeah.
There's also opportunity to try out some local pastimes.
Oh, strangest bagpipe ever tried.
But away from the hubble bubble of modern Egypt, most visitors come here to feast their eyes on what the ancient Egyptians left behind. And there's one site in particular I've got in mind.
What we all come to see is that last remaining wonder, the seven great wonders of the ancient world.
Just 13 minutes drive out of central Cairo stands the most famous architectural legacy of the ancient Egyptian civilization. It can be a bit of a white-knuckle ride getting there. But if you do survive the taxi journey, the site is truly awesome. These are the famous pyramids of Giza, dating from the 4th dynasty. The largest is the Great Pyramid, standing over 130 metres tall, built by Pharaoh Khufu, also known as Cheops, and finished around 2530 BC. The pyramid of his son, Khafre, who also went by the name of Khafre, is a tad smaller and finished 30 years later. While the smallest of the three main pyramids is that of Menkaure, completed around 2470 BC.
Knowing who built what and when is all well and good, but to be honest, I find all those names and dates a bit confusing. Besides, from my geological perspective, the tour guides always miss out the most interesting stuff, the rocks.
The rock in the pyramid, how is it formed?
I don't know. The gentleman, he know everything.
Perhaps we know it in Russian, but not in English.
Do you speak English?
No.
A little? No, nothing? Oh dear. I'm wanting to know where the rock in the pyramid has come from.
A very good pyramid.
Yeah. They'll think I'm completely mad. No one knows anything about rocks. It's very disappointing.
Honestly, I don't know. I don't know. Nah. Geologisch gesehen.
Ja.
Die kommen nicht von geografisch, aber geologisch ist was
so.
Help!
How did the rock form?
I don't know, you tell us.
These great big blocks of rock weren't always as inanimate as they are now. And neither were they as dry and dusty. They actually started off life as living, breathing creatures, swimming around in the ocean.
I'm going on a geological excursion back in time to find out just how animals got turned into solid rock. Imagine I've travelled back to the Eocene era, 50 million years ago. Yes, I know there weren't boats then, but bear with me here. It was an age when the dinosaurs had become extinct, and this part of the world was much wetter than it is today. modern-day Egypt was actually submerged underwater, covered by an ocean called the Tethys.
The Tethys Ocean was huge, more than five times bigger than today's Mediterranean. It stretched from the Alps to the Himalayas, and of course they weren't there yet. But beyond its size, the Tethys Ocean floor was a giant rock factory, providing material to build some of Egypt's greatest monuments.
The raw material for this subaquatic rock factory was the marine wildlife. The Tethys was teeming with creatures whose descendants still live in the oceans today. But only certain types of sea life would eventually help create the rock used in the pyramids.
The geologically important animals are the ones without a backbone, the invertebrates, clams, corals, snails, but mainly billions of tons of microscopic plankton.
Although spineless, plankton and the other marine invertebrates have hard body parts, which contain a substance called calcium carbonate. This was the key ingredient to making the rock. When the animals died, their flesh would have decayed or been eaten, leaving the hard calcified bits to come to rest on the ocean floor.
Over millions of years, tons and tons of the dead animal body parts would have accumulated on the seabed.
Think of it as like making a geological sandwich. But these leftovers would be lifeless animals.
I want to just stab me if I do it.
No, I will.
Oh, no, I don't want that. I want some of that. That's what I want. And I want some. Yeah. Right. Nearly there. Oh, I don't want that. That looks disgusting. I'll take that. Right.
Now, slowly but surely, the layers of dead animals would have got squashed and compacted together, not by some giant arm, but by the weight of the new dead creatures that were continually being deposited on top.
Because the dead sea life was laid down as fragments or sediment, this stone sandwich, which formed over millions of years, is called sedimentary rock.
What were once living sea creatures have been transformed to a type of sedimentary rock called limestone.
If you look carefully, you can often still see the animal remains in the rock. But creating a heap of limestone underneath the ocean floor wasn't much use as a building material, unless you were a fish, with planning permission. Fortunately, the ancient Egyptians wouldn't need to go to the rock because the rock would come to them, as nothing in geology stays still for very long. Over time, one of the most important driving forces of nature brought the limestone up from below the seafloor direct to the early builders.
Think of this egg as the world. The shell is the Earth's crust, but it's not solid. It's broken into a number of pieces called tectonic plates. This one is the African plate, and it's moving northwards into the European one.
As part of this massive continental movement, sections of the Tethys ocean floor were physically pushed up from the watery depths. What was the seabed had emerged from the water to become the bedrock of northern Egypt. Here in Giza, it was that same limestone rock upon which Pharaoh decided to build his pyramid. It's thought that these behemoths were built to act as eternal resting places, homes for the king's earthly remains once they'd passed on into the afterlife. Obsessed with what lay beyond death, Pharaoh believed that to guarantee the immortality of his soul, his body had to be preserved for eternity. Pharaoh also believed that his body should be very close to the stars and the sun. To provide his soul easy access to the heavens, his burial house had to be as tall as possible.
From my geological point of view, it's actually a much more practical explanation as to why the Egyptians built giant pyramids.
First off, to stand any chance of lasting for all eternity, the obvious thing to do was to build the mausoleum out of rock. Thanks to geology, there was a shed load of limestone right on Pharaoh's doorstep. But his builders were doubly lucky. Their limestone came in preformed, ready-made chunks, naturally cracked as a result of the massive geological collision between Africa and Europe.
Imagine this chocolate bar as a layer of limestone on the front part of the African plate. As a result of the collision, the African plate is getting pushed down underneath the European one. Now, if I press down on this, you can see a series of cracks appear. That's because the downward pressure of my fingers is sending energy through the bar, forming the cracks.
These are the Mukattam Hills, overlooking Cairo, where much of the rock for the pyramids was quarried. Here, the limestone was cracked in two directions, naturally forming large square blocks, which were then cut out and used to build with. So Pharaoh had loads of rock for his mausoleum, but to be close to the heavens, he needed a really tall building. And I mean gigantic.
To build the Great Pyramid, this one here, took nearly 2.5 million giant blocks, each one weighing well over 2 tons. I mean, the manpower needed must have been phenomenal. But fortunately, geology once again came to the rescue.
In the shape of the River Nile. The Nile is the longest river in the world and is the lifeblood of Egypt. Without it, Egyptian civilization as we know it just wouldn't exist. The river begins life over 3,500 kilometers away in the mountains of East Africa. Conveniently for the Egyptians, the Nile drains all the way to the Mediterranean, straight through their country.
During the time of the pharaohs, every year for 3 months, heavy rains in the heart of Africa would cause the Nile to flood here in Egypt.
Flooding may not sound like a good thing, but it was essential to revitalize the farmland either side of the river, bathing it in rich, fertile soils. Yet for the duration of the flood, the thousands of farmers had very little to do. So Pharaoh killed 2 birds with 1 stone.
The potentially restless workers needed to be kept occupied. And with summer holidays yet to be invented, Pharaoh had the ideal project to keep them busy. Building a pyramid.
It's thought that over 20,000 men worked in 3-month shifts, labouring for over 20 years just to build the Great Pyramid alone. But of all the shapes Pharaoh could have chosen for his everlasting mausoleum, why pick a pyramid? If you want to make a pile of rocks as tall as possible, there's one particular shape that will allow you to do this much better than any other. Whether the Egyptians realised it or not, it's no coincidence that pyramids mimic another naturally occurring shape. mountains.
Mountains and pyramids have to act against gravity and hold up their own weight. And the shape of a pyramid is a really effective way of spreading the load.
The few stones at the top only have to support their own weight. But lower down, where the weight's much greater, there's more blocks to share the load.
The pyramid builders took advantage of the rock's natural strength, which was rooted in the way it was originally formed by compression beneath the Tethys Ocean. Put limestone blocks under pressure by stacking them on top of each other, and they should remain strong for what could be an eternity.
It's like sitting on a big tea cosy.
Hey, whoa!
I'm not denying that the pyramids are an amazing achievement, but if I was being picky, there's just one major drawback. They made a monstrously huge building, but the space inside's about the size of that tour bus.
I suppose a compact, cosy, easy to maintain space is fine. If you're dead. But the ancient Egyptians also wanted magnificent buildings where their gods could be worshipped by the living.
They wanted to build not a triangular tomb, but a temple with a roof. And for that, we need to head south. Onward!
As Egyptian temples go, you don't get much better than this. The Temple of Amun at Karnak in Luxor. It's a wonder of architectural creativity. Yet these buildings look the way they do because of the rocks. Founded around 2000 BC by Pharaoh Senmusret I, it covers an enormous one of the Egyptian temples.
Pretty impressive when you consider it's just a giant sandcastle.
When the Egyptians built this place, they were again constrained by the rocks that geology had provided them. As with the pyramids, the builders here turned to the local stone, but it wasn't the same as that found up north.
It's less than a day's drive south of the pyramids, but here the Egyptians used a different kind of sedimentary rock, called sandstone.
Remember, Egypt was originally under the Tethys Ocean. What would eventually become Luxor was actually quite close to the ancient shoreline. Over millions of years, prehistoric rivers would have washed huge quantities of sand into the ocean. This then got compacted over time to form sandstone. Like other types of sedimentary rock, sandstone was a very good building material.
Imagine these wafers are layers of sandstone. Just like the limestone used in the pyramids, you stack them up, push down, it's very strong. Ideal for building giant walls.
But the Egyptians still had to work out how to build and support a roof. They discovered that sedimentary rock, whether it was the sandstone here or the limestone used in the pyramids, had two major architectural flaws.
To support a large roof, you're going to need some sort of columns. And to make columns from sandstone, the obvious thing to do would be to dig out some long horizontal lengths, turn them 90 degrees, stand them upright. But look what happens. The layers just break apart.
Sedimentary rock is only really strong when put under pressure, with its internal layers being pushed together in compression, just like when the rock was first formed.
So the temple builders cheated!
This cavernous room in the centre of the temple is known as the Great Hypostyle Hall. Its To make these giant columns, first, the Egyptians cut the sandstone into small blocks with rounded off edges. Then, by stacking the blocks on top of each other, in layers, they kept the rock in compression, yet were able to create very tall, round columns.
The Egyptians had got the support structures they needed. Now they wanted a magnificent stone roof, and this meant overcoming another problem.
A sandstone roof slab is only strong when under compression, which was fine at either end, where it was held up by columns. But the unsupported bit in the middle would be under a different force, called tension. This posed a dilemma.
Put the columns too far apart and the roof stone would collapse.
To get round this problem and yet still hold up a stone roof that originally stretched across the entire hall, the builders virtually filled a room with over 130 giant columns.
The guidebooks might tell you that this hall of columns was deliberately created by the ancients to resemble a swamp of papyrus. However, as a geologist, I see it a different way. Because they were restricted by the properties of the rocks to hand, this was the only way they could support such a large stone roof. It's an amazing sight, but it does look a little bit like a storeroom for columns.
With a desire to create large, awe-inspiring temples, the Egyptians established the skills to actually shape rock into columns and crossbeams, otherwise known as posts and lintels. This became the fundamental way to support large, heavy roofs. In the geological lottery of the Med, the hand the Egyptians were dealt dictated the grand designs they used. And their techniques had not gone unnoticed.
We obviously weren't the first to see this monumental stone architecture. Some of the earliest visitors were the ancient Greeks. What they took back home was much more than just memories. What they learned from the Egyptian stonemasons would inspire them to go one better.
Greece is a major tourist destination in the Med. Although many of us skip off to the islands, the capital, Athens, is the place to see the defining style of ancient Greek architecture. Over 1,000 years after Karnak was built, the Greeks were a civilization on the up. They wanted to go large, building impressive monumental structures. But like the Egyptians before them, they still had to build using materials they had to hand. With a wetter climate, up on the hills grew vast forests. And before the 6th century BC, the Greeks used wood to hold up their temple roofs. Although plentiful, wood was vulnerable to fire and decay. And its limited strength restricted the size and scale of the roofs it could support.
Which is why the Greeks were so excited when travellers returning from Egypt brought with them the expertise to carve round stone columns. Told you rocks were important.
The Greeks quickly put their new skills into practice, replacing the wooden columns with carved stone ones.
The thing was, geology had dealt the Greeks a slightly different hand. In addition to limestone, which was still available, the Greeks had something very special on their doorstep the Egyptians just didn't have. A rock called marble.
This rock completely seduced the ancient Greeks. Once they got their hands on it, nothing else would do. It was marble that put ancient Greece on the architectural map.
What is marble?
a stone.
Yeah, what? How did the earth form it?
Okay, Uncle John?
I'd say very carefully, because it's awful, it's very pretty.
Because we go and you look at it,
but
it's
we
beautiful.
Love your accent.
Oh, thank you very much.
Hey, you've got the wrong cup of wear for that. So that way I've got a sign, Mike.
Marble is like the coolest stone to me, because it lasts forever. It seems like it lasts forever. It's so beautiful.
I don't smoke.
You don't smoke?
No.
Marble. Not Marlborough. Not Marlborough.
Whatever the chemical reaction or whatever you call it is.
Oh, you got an easier question.
That was my easiest.
Marble actually started out life as limestone. But something happened millions of years ago to transform it from one type of rock to the other. Stop. This cake, with its nice horizontal layers, looks like limestone. But as this cake is completely different, the layers have been squished and crumpled to produce a swirl pattern, which is exactly like marble. Now, to see how you turn limestone into marble, I need to go back in time. I'm going back 190 million years to the Jurassic era. Time when the Greek marble first started to form. This may look like a typical hotel pool, but it's exactly what I need to explain how geology provided the driving force to turn limestone into marble. For this demonstration, I'm going to have to get wet again. And I'll need some props. Remember the Earth's crust? Is broken into pieces called tectonic plates. Imagine this red airbed is the African one, and this blue airbed is the European one. Now the plates move around on the Earth's mantle, and these two are on a collision course. The African plate was heading northwards, moving towards Europe. As a result, there was an enormous collision, and this squashed the limestone. But there was more geological action to come. Because Africa's heavier, it gets pushed down underneath the lighter European plate, forming what's called a subduction zone. Within this zone, some of the squashed limestone rock was pushed down into the earth, where it went through further transformation. Although it was the movement of the tectonic plates that provided the driving force needed to convert limestone into marble, it's what happened to the microscopic particles within the rock that makes marble so unique. To show you what I mean, I've rounded up some volunteers down on the beach who'll make great rock particles. With the wind picking up, there's not much else to do today. OK, what I'd like you to do is to get towels down. So if you could just find a little spot and I'll tweak a few of you left and right. You just find a spot, don't be shy. This is the nicest looking limestone I've ever seen. That's fine. Oh, let me give you a hand. And there's a space here. You happy over there? OK, you're looking fantastic. I'm off to have a look at you from up here.
Oh, nice limestone.
I've arranged my volunteers to look like particles of sedimentary rock. They're all making the most of the available space. Now, during the collision of the tectonic plates, that space got smaller. I'm going to go and see what happens if I do the same with those holidaymakers. OK, I just need you all to squeeze together a little bit. shift up a little bit, as close as you can. That's perfect. We're going to get cosy. Squeeze up a little bit to fill those gaps. How are we doing here? Push, push, squeeze, squeeze. Let's get much closer, actually. Let's squash. Just shift up, shift. Like the particles in the sedimentary rock, my holidaymakers have been squeezed into a much smaller space, all packed close together. But we're only halfway towards marble. As well as the pressure, it's starting to get hot.
When the African plate was forced underneath the European one, the rock was taken down, closer to the Earth's hot interior, where it got heated. This caused the rock particles to fuse and interlock. I'm going to get my volunteers to do the same.
Now what I want you to do is to take your right hand, put it on the right shoulder of the person beside you, and take your left leg and touch the person on your right with it. That's fine. Your right arm onto there. Actually, it looks quite disgusting, to be honest. What are you doing? You're not connected to anything now.
The high temperature and pressure caused the rock particles to grow and form new crystals, effectively interlocking the particles and fusing the whole mass together.
So given time, pressure and heat, sedimentary rock was transformed into something called metamorphic rock, the most important of which to the Greeks was marble.
Metamorphic rock comes in many forms, not just marble, and all have been physically altered by heat and pressure inside the Earth's crust. Although the Greek marble was created beneath the ocean, movement of the tectonic plates around 12 million years ago pushed it up from the depths, finally to see the light of day.
As luck would have it, nature provided the Greeks with an enormous hill of quality marble. This is Mount Pentelikon, a stone's throw from the capital Athens, and everywhere you look around here, is marble. This rock face was one of the actual sites where the ancient Greeks used to quarry the very pure white marble. And it was this that they used to create some of the most famous buildings. And look over here. They even had a marble paved road to take the rock straight down into town.
Using their own local marble plus Egyptian stoneworking techniques, the Athenians went to town.
I've come to the famous Acropolis that stands sentinel over Athens. It's one of the most important ancient sites in the Western world, and there's no escaping it. It's wall-to-wall marble.
Perched on top of this rocky outcrop is a monument which, more than any other, epitomises the glory of ancient Greece.
The jewel in the crown of the Acropolis is the Parthenon. It's the largest of the Greek mainland temples, and it's the only one built completely out of Pentelic marble. It's dedicated to the patron of Athens, the goddess Athena, and it took 9 years to build.
Completed in 438 BC, the Parthenon stands 24 metres tall and is over 70 metres long. To keep the patron goddess happy, whose giant statue was housed here, the temple had to be very grand and made of the finest quality stone. In its time, the Parthenon would have been a dazzling edifice in glowing white marble.
It's nowhere near the scale of Karnak and other Egyptian temples, but thanks to marble, the Parthenon's a much more elegant, more sophisticated looking building.
there was originally 46 impressive marble columns surrounding the inner sanctum. And those columns were far more slender than anything created by the Egyptians using sandstone.
But the slimming down of columns didn't stop there. Standing right next to the Parthenon is another testament to the glory of marble. This rather slinky-looking temple is called the Erechtheion, dedicated to the gods Athena and Poseidon.
Here, marble was used to make even thinner, more ornate pillars, a design that would become a mainstay of Greek architecture.
The secret of marble's success lies in the process that created it.
Its fused crystalline structure made it really strong, and the columns could hold significantly more weight than if they were made of sedimentary rock.
The marble crossbeams, or lintels, could also stretch across wider gaps without risk of cracking in the middle. This allowed the Greeks to open out their architecture, producing a greater feeling of space. Marble's special properties also made it ideal for carving. With the Greek craftsmen sculpting highly ornate statues bearing ultra-realistic features. Marble may have started out as an alternative building material to wood, but the Greeks took it and turned it into an architectural art form, leaving behind the ultimate rectangular temple.
But there was another ancient civilization, just round the block, who had discovered that they'd really hit the geological jackpot. And what they did changed the shape of architecture forever. I'm off west, to Italy, to catch up with the Romans.
I've come straight to the heart of the ancient Roman Empire, to the city of Rome. I'm here to see how geology dealt the Roman builders the best hand of all. Founded in 753 BC on the banks of the River Tiber, Rome has a perfect mix of antiquity and urban chic. Although the empire eventually collapsed, there's still quite a lot of ancient Rome to see today, with many impressive buildings standing firm.
At first glance, it looks like most of the ancient Roman buildings were made of brick.
This feast of bricks is Trajan's Market, built, unsurprisingly, during the reign of Emperor Trajan, around AD 114. The bricks used to build this ancient department store were made using mud and clay dug from the riverbanks along the Tiber Valley. Now, the ever-practical Romans thought up an ingenious strategy to make the bricks very hard-wearing.
Using wood-fired kilns to bake their skinny mud bricks, the Romans had created an incredibly strong and very durable material to build with. But the mud they used to make these bricks is not the geological jackpot I'm talking about. Where the Egyptians had sedimentary rock and the Greeks had their metamorphic marble, the Romans had something far more potent. It's what's behind these bricks that was the key to the creation of some of their most spectacular buildings.
What geological process do you think formed the rocks that Rome is built on? That built all these fantastic monuments?
I don't know, a little too complicated there.
They dug out from quarries.
Yeah. But where did they get the stone originally from? Where did the stone come from?
Quarries.
Four quarries.
Places like caves and seas and stuff.
It's a big scientific process. Who knows?
What gave the Romans all these rocks?
quad? The answer isn't immediately obvious, as the Romans discovered their geological bonanza in one of the most unlikely places.
If you were looking for a place in the sun, I'm not sure volcano would be high on your list of must-have local amenities. We tend to think of volcanoes as one of the most destructive geological forces known to man. Destroying buildings, cities, even civilizations, rather than helping to create them.
You wouldn't know it for all this cloud, but I'm on the top of Mount Vesuvius, which overlooks the Bay of Naples, somewhere over there. Now, although it's an active volcano, at the moment, thankfully, there's nothing to report. But in 79 AD, there was a massive eruption. It devastated the whole region. And less than 15 kilometres from here are the remains of two of its most famous casualties, Herculaneum and Pompeii.
When Vesuvius went up, thousands of people were killed within minutes, their flesh vaporised by the intense heat of the eruption. Casts of fallen bodies lie frozen in time where they fell.
For thousands of years before Pompeii perished, the volcanoes of this region had been erupting. And as part and parcel of their destructive nature, they produced all sorts of rocky material. And one of these would be the magical raw ingredient that ultimately would change the way the Romans built forever.
But why volcanoes occurred in Italy in the first place is once again down to a chain of geological events. To show you how they came about, I don't need to go too far back in time. It's a journey to the Miocene era, just 10 million years ago.
Remember the tectonic plates? The African one had collided with the European one and was being pushed down into the earth. Well, beyond a certain depth, the heat was so intense that the rock actually melted to form magma.
Magma is the name given to hot, molten rock that naturally exists deep beneath the Earth's surface.
Imagine this piazza as a cross-section looking down through the Earth below Italy, roughly 10 million years ago. The bollards on the far left represent the surface of the Earth. The area on the right, near the road, mark a point about 100 kilometres below the Earth's surface where the rock had melted to form magma. Now, to find out what happened to that newly formed magma, I need to round up a few little helpers. OK, who wants to look a bit silly?
This school group has volunteered to behave like molten magma for the afternoon.
Anyone feeling silly? Yeah! I agree. Have you guys shrunk or are these big? OK, who needs balloons?
The red balloons are to show that the magma was very hot. Here at 100 kilometres below the Earth's surface, it would have been around an incredible 1,000 Celsius.
All right, get your sticks. There's another one drawn. OK, I think we're ready. Andiamo! This way, I think. Are we all going? Good. The hot molten magma is actually very buoyant. And just like my mini tour group following me across the square, the magma started to rise up from the depths where it was created, heading towards the Earth's surface.
It would have had to push and squeeze its way up through small cracks in the surrounding solid rock. So the magma's progress on the way up was very slow. It was forced to deviate all over the shop. And the longer its journey took, the colder it got.
I think we should just sit down.
Eventually, the magma's progress stopped altogether, way below the Earth's surface.
my magma tour group has now lost so much heat that they've actually solidified into something called igneous rock, one of the best examples of which is granite, like this obelisk.
Granite is an exceedingly hard rock, used sparingly throughout all the ancient civilizations, mostly in ornamental statues and for ornate surfaces. But this wasn't the rock that changed the shape of Roman architecture. The magma wasn't always destined to become rock like granite. 3 million years later, the geological makeup underneath Italy had changed quite dramatically.
The huge force of the collision between Europe and Africa had created a system of fractures and cracks under Italy. And it was this that would lead to the formation of the Italian volcanoes by changing the pathway of the molten magma.
We're all back at the start point once more, 100 kilometres below the Earth's surface. And my mini tour group is once again newly formed hot molten magma.
Let's go! Because of all the cracks and fractures, my magma tour group can now take the much faster, more direct route, heading across the square towards the Earth's surface. It's a bit like taking the geological motorway rather than a scenic route.
All those new cracks in the Earth below Italy effectively opened up a much clearer pathway for the liquid magma. Before it had a chance to cool and solidify, the molten rock would have swiftly risen all the way to the Earth's surface.
The result was a volcanic eruption. Go! But hold on. The magma that escaped onto the Earth's surface could take on a number of different forms. Which form was determined by the effects of trapped gas?
This gas is mostly high-pressured water vapour, which comes from the surrounding rocks.
Just like in this can of beer, within the liquid magma are bubbles of gas. If that gas escapes slowly, then the magma arrives at the surface relatively calmly and oozes out as molten rock. But if the gas remains trapped in the magma, then pressure can build up. And when the molten rock emerges at the surface, the gas escaped all at once.
Just as my bubbly explodes as froth, the pressurised volcanic gas breaks up the erupting magma into tiny pieces.
The result is a cloud of volcanic ash.
This is exactly the type of violent gassy eruption that took place here in the still active Campania region near the town of Pozzuoli, just outside Naples.
An eruption in this area 12,000 years ago produced vast quantities of ash. And it's ash, these tiny fragments of rock, which is the Roman geological jackpot, have been going on about.
Ancient Roman builders thought they could put this volcanic ash to some good use. While making up their building mortar, they discovered, instead of mixing the usual combination of lime and sand, that if they mixed up lime with the ash, it produced an interesting result.
The Romans created a builder's mortar with super strength, which even set in the wet.
It turns out the explosive process that had created the volcanic ash gave it very special chemical properties.
When they mixed volcanic ash with the lime, the two substances reacted in an intimate way, forming very strong and irreversible bonds.
But the ash was to play an even more important role. It was a key ingredient in a uniquely Roman innovation.
The final stroke of genius was to combine ash mortar with lumps of rubble. It produced a building material that the Egyptians and the Greeks could only have dreamt of. A DIY rock called concrete.
The Roman concrete was amazing stuff. It set quickly and was waterproof, great for aqueducts and baths. It even set underwater, perfect for harbours. The Romans also created a very durable building combination by using concrete with their kiln-fired mud bricks. And don't be fooled by all this marble. Most of it hides bricks and concrete underneath. Because it could be moulded, concrete was perfect for building all kinds of new shapes. It was then that the Romans discovered the arch.
Now, the Egyptians and Greeks had arches, but they mainly used them below ground for vaults and sewers. It was the Romans that realised how valuable they'd be above ground, and they made extremely good use of them. Coliseum.
Finished in AD 80 by Emperor Titus, the Colosseum was the centrepiece for Roman revelry, holding over 50,000 spectators. That's more than your average Premier League football stadium. It was here they staged the famous gladiatorial games, pitting Herculean warriors against each other and assorted wild animals. The whole structure of the Colosseum is supported by hundreds of arches.
The arch is so good at its job because of the way it distributes weight. The two sides of the arch are pushing against each other. This means that the weight above is never pressing down the middle. Instead, it's pushed out to the sides and down to the base.
Unlike the post and lintel setup with its stressed out crossbeam, there's no tension in an arch. This means it could not only hold up a great deal more weight, but stretch across much wider gaps. It was the innovation of the arch, combined with their magic concrete, that the Romans were able to produce arguably their greatest architectural achievement. This is the Pantheon, the king of all Roman temples. Located in the heart of the city, it is one of the best preserved of all ancient Roman buildings. Completed around AD 125 by Emperor Hadrian, the word Pantheon literally means all the gods to whom this breathtaking temple was dedicated.
To me, the Pantheon is a pinnacle of Roman building ingenuity. Now, from here, it may look like a rectangular Greek temple, but go inside and you can see just how the Romans changed the shape of architecture. They created a vast circular building with an enormous concrete dome roof.
This giant round building has a roof stretching over 43 metres across. It was the largest unsupported span the ancient world had ever seen, and it would be well over 1,000 years before anyone would better it. In the middle of the roof is a whopping great big hole, or oculus. This allows sunlight in to light the building throughout the day. What amazed everyone was how this huge roof stayed up, apparently suspended in mid-air, with nothing to support it.
Unlike the colonnaded temples built by the Greeks, or the column-packed halls of Egypt, the Romans had created a building with an incredible amount of internal space, completely uncluttered by any obvious support for the roof.
The dome was constructed as a perfect hemisphere. If you think about it, the whole roof is effectively a circle of arches. This means there's no tension in the central structure itself. instead of weight pressing down from the middle of the dome, it all gets pushed out to the sides and down through the base. The weight is then further supported by a series of concrete and brick arches built into the lower walls.
It's a pretty impressive building, but the ever-practical Romans had essentially just copied nature. Take my egg. It's basically two domes joined together. It may look fragile, but it's actually a very strong structure. Now, the span of the egg dome is 30 times greater than the thickness of the shell. And it turns out that the dome roof here is exactly the same. The Parthenon is really a giant egg!
The construction of this colossal man-made egg ultimately relied on geology to provide the right building materials. But it wasn't just the volcanic ash.
The Italian volcanoes also provided the Romans with a whole variety of rocks. The builders of the Parthenon then added these to the ash cement to produce custom-made concrete. Down at the bottom, for the foundation walls, they needed to make up the concrete with something very heavy and strong. So they used basalt. This is a type of lava that's spewed out of the volcano as molten rock and then set solid. It's very dense and incredibly durable. Up in the middle section, to reduce the weight, they used something a bit lighter. A rock called volcanic tuff. And the reason it's not so heavy is because it's actually ash that's been compacted over time to form a lightweight rock. High up at the top of the dome, they had to have incredibly light concrete to keep weight to an absolute minimum. So they added pumice to the mix. Now, like ash, pumice is made when gassy magma explodes out of the volcano to produce an ultra-lightweight rock full of air bubbles. It even floats on water. Thanks to volcanoes, the Romans had the perfect materials to create a unique domed building. The Parthenon stands as one of the greatest achievements of Roman architecture and engineering, and it set the shape of things to come.
The ancient monumental buildings that I've seen in each country all have very distinctive forms.
Hey, whoa!
And it seems to me that these were dictated by much more than just the beliefs and traditions of the different civilizations.
The shape and style of ancient building was also determined by the geological hand that each country was dealt. And this was a card game that started millions of years before man had even evolved, right back when the Mediterranean was first formed.
Geology provided the ancients with the raw materials. And by taking advantage of what each different country had right on their doorstep, the great civilizations each left us unique monuments that we can admire today. The Egyptian pyramids are a tribute to sedimentary rock. Rectangular Greek temples are a triumph in marble. And gigantic Roman domes are all thanks to volcanoes. For further information on Open University programs, please go to open2.net.